Hello, and welcome to a Chess. This video is a remaster of my video on the Immortal game with improved sound quality. And of course, the physical chessboard along with the 2D graphics. I hope you will enjoy. Adolf Anderson was born a little more than 200 years ago on July 6, 1818, in Breslau. He learned chess as a boy of 9 and grew up to live a quiet, stable, responsible and respectable middle-class life. On the chessboard, however, he epitomized the romantic spirit with passionate, daring and brilliant play. While in society and business, he was modest. He lived with his mother and sister, who he supported as a professor of mathematics. He never married, and his work did not leave him much time to practice chess. We can therefore imagine his surprise when he received a prestigious invitation to the first international chess tournament. At the time, it was the strongest chess tournament ever held. He first declined, noting that the tournament was held in London, far from his home in Breslau, and he was worried about travel expenses. But word of his brilliant play had reached the stately ears of Howard Staunton, the foremost expert on chess and gentleman of the game, and coincidentally also the organizer of this particular event. He wrote Anderson promising to pay all travel expenses should Anderson fail to win any tournament prizes. And even the modest Anderson had to accept such a generous offer. And so the unassuming chess master packed his bags and left for London. Upon arrival, he entered the tournament and started delivering a smackdown, quite contrary to his polite but disinterested demeanor. Halfway through the tournament, that he would eventually go on to win by a large margin, he decided to relax with a friendly, casual game against another of the masters. His opponent was a gentleman by the name of Lionel Kieszewski, a very strong master in his own right. The moves they played became so famous that they have now traveled almost 200 years to reach you through the screen. This is the starting position of chess. Such a familiar sight that it is often overlooked in its complexity and beauty. But I want you to really look at this mystical forest of black and white squares. I want you to put yourself there on the board. I want you to imagine that you are this bishop. And then I want you to journey with me into the immortal game. Here you are, on your starting square. eager to launch yourself into battle. Anderson reaches down from far above and pushes the pawn, with the promise that you will soon find yourself in the most ferocious of attacks. But first, due preparation must be made. Kieślarski answers with e5, and Anderson showed his intention with f4, the king's gambit opening. His plan is to lure the black queen on a dangerous mission deep behind enemy lines. Kieślarski is not afraid and captures the pawn, probably expecting the usual defensive move, knight to f3, which would defend h4 and keep the queen out. But no. Anderson instead plays his light squared bishop to c4, attacking the weak square on f7. You are the dark squared bishop, standing on your starting square, wondering what the master has in store for you. The black queen darts into the position with a check, forcing the king to move and forever lose the right to castle. The black army is ready to follow their queen, their Jeanne d'Arc, into battle. Kieślarski smells something in the position. Is it potential? He gives up a pawn with b5, allowing the bishop to capture. He wants to clear the way for his center pawns and distract the pesky bishop from the weak square on f7. Now the knight joins the raiding party, readying itself to leap into the attack and join his queen. But the black attack has paused just for a split second here to develop the army. And it is at this moment that Anderson seizes the initiative. He looks down on the battlefield, picks up his knight and places it on f3. For the first time, we can see a method behind the master's move, a theme. He has given up his king's safety and allowed this deadly queen so very near. But his royal guard is with him, ready to strike back and willing to die defending him. For now, the knight attacks the queen and she must move. She goes to h6, and as you look up upon the master far above, you notice a slight smile as his gaze crosses yours. He has plans for you. He plays d3, and you feel the thrill of battle tingle down your spine. You see the queen in your line of fire, and you know that you are destined for greatness. Kieślarski moves his knight to h5, committing himself even more to the attack. The knight threatens a deadly check on g3, where it cannot be captured because the queen pins the pawn to the rook. The white knight leaps to the king's defense on h4, and the black queen moves again. She is on g5 now, threatening the knight, who simply goes to f5, defending g3, and perhaps thinking about the possibilities that comes with being this close to the enemy king. Kishyatsky sits up straight, flashing a wry smile across the board. He plays c6, a move he prepared some time ago. And now your brother, the light squared bishop, is under attack. The black army threatens to regain the lost time while the bishop retreats. Anderson sits motionless above you. You stretch your neck, trying to read, trying to glean his intention, but his face betrays nothing. In one fell swoop, he strikes with pawn to g4. Did you catch a humorous glimpse in his eyes as your gaze is crossed? You look to your brother, who was seemingly just sacrificed, and you understand. You are now the center point of this battle. The pawn could have been captured en passant like this, but your revenge would be devastating. Kishyarsky seems puzzled. He moves the knight to c6, attacking g4 twice. Again, Anderson ignores the attack on your brother and slides the rook to g1, calmly protecting the pawn. Your brother falls. But the net is tightening around the black queen. The h-pawn launches forward, forcing her back. She retreats. The pawn continues the chase, and she has to go back to g5. She seems ripe for the taking, and the master prepares the execution with queen to f3. You are ready to capture on f4, trapping and capturing the helpless queen. Kishyatsky should be on the verge of defeat, but he seems calm. Have you missed something? The black knight retreats to its starting square and provides a route for escape. Did the master overlook this defense? Your train of thought is interrupted when the master suddenly grabs you and calmly slides you across the board, knocking the pawn on f4 off. You are so close to the enemy queen now that you can even see her flinch ever so slightly. She goes to f6, escaping your attack and threatening the pawn on b2. The attack is blocked by knight to c3. But this defensive move has given Kishyatsky a second to catch his breath and mobilize his forces. The dark squared bishop darts out, slicing through the center, attacking the rook and getting dangerously close to the king. You look around the battlefield, counting. Yes, the opposing army is larger than ours. We have been outnumbered since the master sacrificed the bishop. But the black divisions seem disorganized. The horses still at the stables, the the rooks passive in the corners. You get a feeling of purpose, of intent, as if the master has known all along, as if the moves are all notes in a symphony, and something is slowly building to a crescendo. The master picks up the knight and confidently places it in the center. The center. We have almost complete control over the center, you whisper to yourself, as the black queen swoops away from the attack and capture the pawn on b2. You can feel how close you are to the black king. His assassins are attacking both the rooks, but if you only get the dark squares under control, the middle of the board is yours. You feel your master's fingers around you. He slides you slowly closer and lands you on d6. Of course, you think to yourself as you stare at your black counterpart. He can't capture me. Mate would quickly follow. Instead, he shoots down and snaps the rook right off. It looks dangerous. The queen is looming nearby, attacking the rook, threatening check. But don't you worry. Master has got you covered. He has not invested all this material to let you down. No, the crescendo is nearing, and the lead melody is played in a minor chord on the dark squares. Your literal area of expertise. Turning your head, you see the master reach down and push the pawn to e5. Closing the dark squares shut for the black army with an almost disinterested calm. Kieszewski looks up at Anderson, a wrinkle on his forehead. But surely, he mutters to himself. He stares at the board. A minute passes. A minute more. Then he captures the rook. Looks up with this strange, puzzled look on his face. And says, check. The master moves the king to e2. As if simply acting out some script written a long time ago. The black knight comes to a6, protecting c7. You see the knight to your left grin as it jumps to g7. Check. King d8. Only move. You are so near. You are so near to the king. If only you could go to e7, you would deliver checkmate. But the enemy knight covers the square. You are completely calm though, completely confident that the master has foreseen this and has an answer for you. And he has. Of course. Queen to f6 check, sacrificing the last major piece. The audience gasps. Now they all see it. Kieszewski just smiles. He's a competitive man, but he's a chess player first and foremost, and as such, he appreciates true beauty. He captures the queen as it is the only legal move, and now you get your time in the sun. The master moves you to E7 and calmly exclaims, "Checkmate." The audience cheers as the defeated but smiling Kieschatzky extends his hand. Anderson accepts it and thanks him for a game well played. Some time passes as the onlookers offer their opinions and suggestions for moves. Kieschatzky humors them and refutes their ideas at every stage, occasionally looking up to Anderson, who confirms his analysis with a slight nod. After the commotion has died down and the onlookers have rushed away to analyze the game on available boards, Kieschatzky thanks Anderson and takes his leave. And then there is a moment of silence. Complete silence. The master looks down on you, allowing his eyes to betray a glimpse of his pride. He sends you a smile and whispers, "It is not about how many pieces leave the board. It is about those